Good morning, Tab family, guests and friends. It's so good to be before you. It's so good to be able to have a way of being able to worship and interact together. We are in the hub, and as you know, we are virtual again this Sunday. And yet, God has spared us to see another Sunday. I say it that way because this week has been full of things that have happened. There have been quite a few shootings around our city, including two officers that were shot, St. Louis City police officers, as they pursued a car that had young men in it who were connected to a homicide from the previous day. And so these are praying times. So the first thing I'm gonna ask you this morning is if this week, or even today, that you would just set aside some time to pray for police officers, for firefighters, those who respond and run to trouble instead of from trouble, to protect you and I. So that's first this morning. Secondly, I want to put these two announcements in your ear. You're going to see them come up on the screen. The first one is men next Sunday after church. We're going to gather as we do a reboot of men's ministry. So please come out. Even if you watch us virtually, come down after watching us virtually and join the men here in the hub. They'll be in the community space, and we look forward to you doing that. The brothers have some exciting things to share with you and share with you how we can use your help, your gifts, and expertise. The second thing is Women's Corner virtually will happen February 24th. That's a Thursday at 6 p.m. You don't want to miss this, ladies. I'm looking forward to gathering together, and for all those who do join us virtually and have something to say thank you for just participating and engaging. And then the next Women's Corner will be in person, and we'll be getting that date out to you soon. So I'm excited and I'm concerned. I'm excited about what God is doing, and I'm concerned about the things that are happening in our city. Here's the good news of it all. Is that God is in control. Often we say still as if there's questions there if he's in control. No, God is still in control. And when we seek his face and follow his plan, it may lead us to uncomfortable spaces and sometimes even uncomfortable places. But know that God is with you. He's with us. He's with our church and the church to do his will in the earth. So take care. God bless. Enjoy this wonderful music ministry as they come and sing. And also, if you're hearing that great music, just type Go Ahmad in the comments, because that's my son, my firstborn, tickling the keys. Take care, God bless, and see you soon.
Yes, Lord.
I got rain.
Say, Lord, you reign
above every name.
Yay. Say, my God reign.
My God reign.
Say, I got rain. Lord, you
reign above every name.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Oh, say my God reign.
My God reign.
Say our God reign.
Our God reign.
Lord, you
reign above every name.
Say my God reign.
My God reign.
Say our God reign.
Our God reign.
Lord, you
reign. above every name.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Oh, say my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Said our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Lord, you
reign above every name.
Say my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Said our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Lord, you
reign above every name.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Oh, oh, say my God reign.
My God reign.
Said our God reign.
Our God reign.
Lord, you reign
above every name.
You
reign above every name.
With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Yes, Lord. With power.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign. Above every name.
Say my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Said our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Lord, you
reign above every name.
Over my circumstance.
Over my circumstance. Giving me another chance. You reign.
Say over.
Over my circumstance. Giving me another chance,
you reign. Over.
Over my circumstance, giving me another chance,
you reign. You reign, Lord. You reign. Over.
Over my circumstance, giving me another chance.
Come on.
to praise thy name. Father of glorious, or of victorious, come and reign over us, come and reign over us. Father of glorious, or of victorious, come and reign over us, come and reign over us. We come to praise, we come to praise, we come to praise.
Good morning, good morning. So good to be standing here, ready to walk into the Word of God. We are going to conclude the series Good News today by looking at Romans 1, verses 8 through 15. So if you have your Bible or your phone or however you read God's Word, let's turn in the Bible to Romans chapter 1, verses 8 through 15. And next week, we will start a new series called Fallen. Fallen. Yeah. All of us are broken and we all are fallen. But grace and thanks be to God for His healing and restoration by the work done by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So that's next week. This week, we're closing out the good news. The good news. If you've got Romans chapter 1, starting at verse 8, just type amen across all platforms, YouTube, Facebook, website. Just type amen. And before we read this text, I want to encourage you one more time. Who did you invite in to watch this morning? Who did you call and text and say, hey, jump on our online service? If you haven't done that, here's an opportunity to do it. Listen, we invite people for sales. We invite people over for a variety of things, even in the pandemic. Some of y'all have been looking, you've been all over the globe. So if we can do all of that, we can easily pick up our phones and choose at least one person this morning right now and just say, hey, would you jump on, even if it's not the whole time, would you jump on and join me for God's word? Yeah, let's do it. All right, here we go. Romans chapter 1, starting at verse 8. Word of God says, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed throughout the whole world. For God, whom I serve in my spirit in the preaching of the gospel of his Son, is my witness as to how unceasingly I make mention of you. Always in my prayers, making requests, if perhaps now at last by the will of God, I may succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you so that I may impart some spiritual gift to you that you may be established. That is, that I may be encouraged together with you while among you, each of us by the other's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that often I have planned to come to you and have been prevented so far, so that I may obtain some fruit among you also, even as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So for my part, I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. Tag this text this morning, a good report, a good report. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and we honor you today, for there's no one like you. God, we pray now that your word take over, that it change us, that it challenge us, that it comfort and convict us, may it shape us, that we may walk forward looking more like Christ. And Lord, may us looking like your son, may we also live as he's called us to live, and may that be our witness, and may it lead others to you. May it draw somebody this morning who doesn't know you. May it encourage somebody who's getting to know you. May it strengthen the believer who's been walking with you a long time. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen. A good report. My first internship was with Olin Corporation, and I was nervous because I did not know whom I would be working with. I have been told by a few during the interview process and touring the facility that the gentleman who would be my boss was known for being a good person. That didn't bring too much comfort because everybody's definition of good is not the same. And oftentimes, it's not necessarily even based on a biblical construct. And yet, that's what kept coming up. How kind, how nice, how good he was. When we finally connected later on that day, after 15 minutes of conversation, I began to understand why the report about him came as it did. Because just in 15 minutes, he had shown that all those things that had been said about him and more by others who, some I knew well, others I knew somewhat, a few I did not know at all. The common thread was his character spoke to his abilities and the causes that he engaged within the company, and it told a lot about his success. And he was adamant about making sure that my time there, whether it be for one summer or a lifetime, I was successful. His report matched his walk. His report lined up with who he really is. His report paved the way for a long-term relationship between him and I. And much like that report, I believe Paul, the writer of this letter, writing to the church at Rome, in this section develops a good report. It's something to be known and known well of. Not that we all make everybody happy, not that we all please everyone. And incidentally, if you don't know this already, I'm just gonna tell you that there's no such thing as making everyone happy or pleasing everyone. Rather, to have a good report is for who people say you are to match who you really are. To have a good report is to say that the characteristics that describe you don't only describe you in one particular context or setting, but they are transferable and speak to your everyday living. That the people who see you at home feel about you the same way that the people on the job to the functions. In essence, they might not agree with all your actions, but they know that your actions and your words spoken line up with whom God created you to be. Today, Paul starts off in this verse 8. Giving us this honorable mention. If you look at it, verse 8, coming back across your screen, it says, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed throughout the whole world. As I've said before, but hasten to say now again, that the whole world at that point was as far as Spain. It was not determined all the other continents and all that we know of today. However, sufficient to say that the Romans were saints who were known for their love for the sovereign God, for the one whom sacrificed everything, Jesus Christ, to give them eternal life and salvation. They were known by their faith. He said, I thank God for you. He gave them a godly thanks. He said, I lift up to you through Jesus. I give thanks for you. I give thanks for the faith in you. He wasn't so much speaking about their person as much as he was about their faith, which seems to say that how they lived, how they treated one another, how they engaged one another, how they carried on together, spoke volumes to people. Because keep in mind, Rome was a mixture of ethnicities, cultures, and religions. It was an incubator for business, commerce, as well as other pleasures that were not godly. It was the center of the universe at that time. It was all roads lead to the capital city of Rome. It was the place to be. And even in the midst of a culture that pushed back on them, catch that, they were known for their faith. I wonder when people see you and I and see the Tabernacle, how are we known? If I come to the place where you work next week, are you known for your faith? If I come to the next function with you and your friends, not just your church friends, but your friends outside of church, are you known for your faith? Paul says, I thank God that you, meaning Rome, the church at Rome, is known for your allegiance and your activity towards our God. You're lined up with the kingdom agenda. People know it. They don't have to ask you. You don't have to wear a sticker. You don't have to put on a cross. They just know by your faith who you are and whose you are. Have you ever been around somebody and you watch them for a while and then later on happen to see them at some church function and go, I didn't even know you knew Jesus, because the behavior did not line up with what they say they believe. Belief drives behavior. One preacher said it this way, and I've held on to it. He said, I can tell what you believe by the way you behave. And Paul says, Rome, your church is known for its faith. It's known from how you live and live out who God is in your life. Verse 9 says, for the God whom I serve, my spirit in the preaching of the gospel of his son, it is my witness as to how unceasingly I make mention of you. So Paul first gives this godly thanks, and then he gives this gracious testimony. He says, as God is my witness, I'm praying for you. There's something about when God's people pray for one another. To be known by faith and to be known as a praying community is a powerful thing, because in that, God can move in miraculous ways. Not only can he move in miraculous ways, but then there seems that God releases resources to do things that others say can't get done. Paul said, I haven't seen y'all, excuse my language, I haven't met y'all, but I don't have to see you or meet you, because I've been greeted where I am in Corinth by your faith. I wonder, before we step in a place, not only by faith, but by our way of prayer, are we known in that way? And this message, if you haven't caught already, is going to ruffle some feathers. It's going to dig into us this morning, because I believe God is calling us as his people, even in the midst of this pitiful pandemic, to be people who are known for our faith and for our praying. Yes, and for our carrying forth his plan. It's not enough to say we love him. We show that we love him by how we engage. Come here for a moment, if you will allow me to insert, reset in here. Relationships is that are. How are we acting out in relationship? Are we praying for one another? Are we caring for one another? Do you have somebody here in the Tabernacle that you can reach out to, talk to, pray with, and share in confidence? If not, we need to do better. We need to build better. We need to orchestrate better. Why? Because that's what it takes to make it and live a life of faith. If you haven't caught on already, following God can be an audacious task. Yeah, whoever said that Pollyanna faith stuff where everything about following God is easy and you turn around three times and you put your offering in and that God gonna bless you and cause stuff to rain down, I've yet to see that happen. The reality of it is, this is a daily thing where God is saying, daily I'm doing a work in you. That's why Jesus said, pick up your cross and follow me. It's a daily thing to make the choice to take the cross with us wherever we go. And the church at Rome was known for prayer and for their faith. Reminds me of a seminary professor I had before I even touched foot on Covenant's campus. I had heard about this man. I had been told about him. He was known for his calm demeanor, his biblical intelligence, his scholarly intellect, and yet his kind, warm, and compassionate heart. Known for years, before I ever attended one class, this man was known not only in St. Louis, and is known not only in St. Louis, but across our country and beyond globally. And when I finally had the privilege of taking his apologetics class, I saw why he was known, why his faith spoke for him. Because not only did he instruct us in such a gentle and challenging and comforting and way for us to grow spiritually, but then he shepherded us and pastored us even outside of class. He led us and guided us. He helped us be better husbands and better fathers, better students. Most of all, he led us just by his faith, by how he lived. He led us to be better Christians. And I had the privilege of having him as the leader of my covenant group, which is like a small group that we met once a week and shared, six of us together, about our struggles, our triumphs, and everything in between. And the prayers that he will release over us as young men have carried us all into long, fruitful seasons of ministry. The prayers that he put out over our families have carried our families forward. The prayers that he put forth over us as we enter in the academics and writing papers and taking exams, both written and oral, he covered us in prayer. He lived his faith. And it's to this day that I reference him so much so. He was known so much so by his praying and his faith that many would say this statement, what would Jerem do? You know how it normally says, what would Jesus do? He was known and is known so much for his faith, they say, what would Jerem do? I find that highly honorable and humbling that somebody would be known in that way. And I just believe what Paul is saying to us here about the church at Rome is that they are known in that way, even in places and spaces where people did not believe and were hostile towards their belief. And yet they lived in such a way that it broadcast who they were. And I would suggest to you this morning that God is calling you and I to a place in our walk with him where people know us for our faith and for our praying ability. Praying ability. Not problem ability. Yeah. Too often we've been known for being trouble and being against everything versus being known for our faith. And so Paul gives honorable mention to the church at Rome. But not only does he give honorable mention to the church at Rome, he gives this hopeful mission. In verse 10, coming across the screen, he says, always in my prayers, making requests, if perhaps now, at last, by the will of God, I may succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you so that I may impart some spiritual gift to you that you may be established. Paul had been praying to see them, praying mightily that God would allow him the ability to go to Rome, because he sensed God not only calling him to Rome, but to get to Rome to set up a base of operations to do ministry in Spain, to reach the far edges of the earth, because Paul believed his calling was to the Gentiles. His calling was to preach to people in places where foundations of Jesus Christ has not been set. And so Paul says, I long to come to you. I'm praying in that way that God will release me. I have a passion to see you, that we might impart one to another. Notice the great apostle, the man who is known for his walking with God now, says, not only do I want to come and help you, but in verse 12, he says, I want us to mutually benefit from being in someone's presence. Hear me today. Make sure the people that you surround yourself with in the kingdom bring a mutual encouragement. Do not always surround yourself with people who drain you. Do not always surround yourself with people who drag you down. But you should be around some people where you, when you walk away, you feel lifted up. You should be around people that when you walk away from them, you feel and know you've been encouraged. And catch this, you've done the same for them. Because nobody likes somebody who's always making debits and never any deposits. Nobody likes somebody who's always abstracting and never have the ability to add. Nobody likes somebody who's always taking away from and not being able to tarry and bring something to the table. And Paul says, listen, I long to come to you so that we can produce and impart fruit one to another. Here's a question coming across your screen. Do you impart or do you just enable? Say it another way. Put it this way on the screen. Do you add or do you subtract? Do you bring fruit or do you just bring foolishness? Paul says, I'm longing to get there. I'm longing to come to you because I believe God has something in my gift that will enrich you and that you've got something in your gift that will enrich me. Hear me, every child of God watching this morning. When you accepted Christ, all of us were imparted with some spiritual gift. God's spirit living in us empowers us with some spiritual gift that he has ordained for us to have. Therefore, there is no such thing as, well, I have nothing to offer. Who told you that lie? There is no such thing as, I don't have anything that I can say or do in the kingdom. Who told you that lie? That's not true. That is Satan casting doubt. When God delivered you, he delivered you from so that you could be delivered into something that enriches the kingdom. Paul says, I have this hopeful mission to get to you because I believe that you will impart something to me and I will impart something to you. First job I had working for Hallmark Cards, gentleman who walks up on the job and he speaks and says who he is. We walk not knowing that we would be in the same department. We sit down, our desks are not too far from each other. We see each other. Lunchtime comes, I'm sitting at a table, I'm eating, and quite frankly and honestly, I'm eating so that I can move on. I really didn't want to do the small talk, but this gentleman sat down and just struck up conversation. And if you ever been there where you really don't want to talk, but at the same time you don't want to be rude, you're trying your best to put on your face so that you are somewhat engaging, but yet at the same time sending the message like, look here, I'm just trying to get through this and get on out of here and get back to what I do. He did this day after day. And then finally, I let my guard down. I said, okay, I see that he wants to have some type of relationship. I don't know why. I don't know where this is going. But all right, we're going to do this. And so from that moment on, the wisdom that he had, the way he walked, the way he lived, his desire to pray, his compassion for others, I watched unfold. I watched us then grow together spiritually by talking not only about the Bible in its proper context, but then talking about how it applied to life. He enriched a young, immature Christian by having a willingness to impart. And he had the audacity to say that when I left that company, he felt that I had imparted so much to him. In my mind, I didn't really have much to offer, but in his mind, he had gained something. What am I trying to say? I'm not trying to lift me up or really lift him up. What I'm trying to do is to get you to see this morning that God has given each and every one of us something. That when we get in the proper place, Paul said, I'm coming, I'm doing my best to get there. When I get in the right place, I have something to impart because it's on purpose. And I want somebody to know this morning that what will help the mission of the kingdom of God is when all of us operate and desire to get to that place so that we can impart that which God has given us. Can I tell you, you were created, I was created, on purpose, for a purpose. Problems are opportunities to show how God has uniquely crafted you for a particular place at a particular time for a particular plan. We look at problems as something to run from, but God is asking us as believers to run to them. And I would suggest, as I wrap in again, encounter that E from reset, evangelism, that E from reset, and S, serving. Catch this now. There are going to be times where we will serve outside of these walls coming up soon as the weather breaks. On a Sunday, we won't even, quote unquote, have church. But we're going to serve people. We're going to impart to them. And catch this. Not as if God ain't already at work in them, but rather understanding that God has already been at work and we're just coming into the story of what God is already doing. That's what Paul is describing here. He's saying, I want to get to you to impart and for you to impart because I'm just coming into the story of what God is already doing in your life. So we see Paul speaks about this honorable mention. He gives this helpful mission, but then he gives this honest message. Catch it now. He's honest about what's happening with him. What builds a good report is when we're honest with other believers about where we are. Don't tell me you're blessed and highly favored when you know you're going through it and you feel like you want to crumble and fall apart. Don't tell me that life is well when all hell is breaking loose. Don't tell me that everything is good when it ain't good. God doesn't ask us to say everything is going good. He just wants us to remember in all things, give thanks for he is good. Paul says, let me give you this honest message. Here it is, verse 13, Paul says, I don't want you to not be aware. He said, brethren, I've been trying to come to you. I've been trying to get to you, but I've been prevented. God was preventing him from getting there. It wasn't Satan. It wasn't an attack of the enemy. It wasn't that he had sinned and done something wrong. God said, the time is not yet. Can you handle a delay? We often say delay is not denial. That sounds real cute and real good, but can you handle delay to the point of believing God will deliver at the appointed time? Paul says, he's got me where I can't come right now. So I'm going to use what he gave me. I'm going to use my pen. When delay happens, oftentimes it's so that we can, watch this, utilize under God's auspices what he's already given us to use. Said another way, delay is purposeful for utilizing gifts that we sometimes let sit dormant. Paul said, I can't get to you, but I can write to you. I can't show up in person, but I can show up in the strength and in the compassion of my words. When's the last time you looked at a delay and said, maybe it's not now, but here's what is now, and here's what I'm going to do while I'm being delayed? Or do you complain and say, God has got it wrong? Yeah, Paul said, here's the honest message. I've been trying to get to you, but I can't get to you yet. Can I share something with you? Not only did he not get to them anytime soon, but when he showed up finally in Rome, He was a preacher and a prisoner. He was awaiting trial to go before Caesar, before he was executed. Did you catch what I just said? The delay led to his development of himself and other believers in other places, because when he writes this, he's at Corinth. And while there, he's in jail. He gets in jail, writes four letters of the New Testament. Talk about utilizing your time effectively. Paul said, just because I'm sitting down does not mean that my gift sits down, and I'm going to utilize what God has placed in my hand. And when he comes to Rome, he comes as a prisoner and a preacher. He's on house arrest. He's seeing people. He's evangelizing government. He's speaking into politics. For all of those who say Christians shouldn't be involved in politics, no, I'm not saying everybody should be a politician. What I am saying, though, is that if the kingdom is not involved in the policies being created, then no wonder they're corrupt. Because only kingdom people can bring a kingdom perspective. You can't expect the world to do what God can do, and God uses his people to do it in the earth. Catch this. Paul is in prison when he shows up in Rome. He's still a preacher. And I'm willing to go out on a limb and say, I'm sure that's not what he had in mind when he wrote this. I want to speak to somebody this morning who's watching, who said, I had this plan, I had this idea, I had this concept, I believe it was God, he was ordering my steps, then I hit a delay, and now things aren't looking the way that I thought they would. Can I suggest to you, they might not look the way that you think they should, but they look exactly how God wanted them to be? Did you hear what I said? It might not have the pretty picture of the portrait that you have performed in your mind, and yet God is using exactly what it is, the way it is, where it is, how it is, that he may be glorified. Could it be he didn't want it to be a fairy tale? He wanted it to be a faith walk. Did you hear me? He didn't want it to be cute and put together nicely. He wanted it to be dirty, nasty, and come out on the other side and show how God can take a mess and turn it into ministry. I hope somebody hears me this morning who's sitting saying, God isn't there. He isn't doing what I thought he would. Yeah, he's not. Because the good report comes when God shows up and then begins to do something that only God can do. So that on the other side of it, you and I can't take credit for it. We can't boast in it, except boasting in the Lord. Paul says, I've been prevented. Don't bark and push back at God's prevention. Lean in to his prevention and say, God, what is it you're saying about the plan? What is it that you're asking of me? Because here's what Paul says, verse 14. He says, I am, catch this, under obligation, both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. The word barbarian means those who are non-wise. Keep in mind that the Greek population that was in Rome believed that they were the smartest, had the most intellect, they were philosophical. And so they believed that everybody who was not Greek was dumb. They believed everybody who didn't look like them, talk like them, act like them, think like them, go to the schools they went to, did not have the mental or the physical capabilities and capacity of the mind to live out truth the way that they lived it out. And oh, by the way, most times their truth was not anchored in the Bible. It was anchored in flesh. So Paul says, whether you think you're smart or not, whether you a Jew or not, whether you're rich or not, whether you got it all together or not, whether you living well or not, whether you are accepted by society or not, I have an obligation. That word obligation in the Greek, it means debt. Paul says, I'm indebted to God to get this good news out to all of you, because that's what God has called me to do. So Paul says, in essence, I've been delayed, I can't get to you, but here's what I can do. I can write about this good news because I'm indebted. I want somebody to hear me as I close this morning, that you and I are indebted. Yes, we are indebted to give this message of God's good news to, watch this, everybody. Everybody, the people we like and the people we don't like. The people who run in our circles and the people who don't. The people that's a part of our networks and the people who are not. The people who help us and the people who hurt us. The people who favor us and the people who act foolish with us. Because God says, because at one point you were foolish. At one point you were outside. At one point you didn't know me. At one point you didn't follow me. At one point you didn't trust me. But yet somebody I sent to you was willing to speak into you so that I could come through them to get through to you. I wonder, do I have anybody who's going to be honest enough this morning to say, God has been tugging on my heart, Pastor, there's somebody I should be sharing, there are some people I should be engaging, and I've been using the pandemic as an excuse of why I can't, when God has created all these other tools so that even if we're not in person, that we can still get together. I want to charge you and admonish you this morning. You indebted. I'm indebted to get this good news to them. Now, here's what I know. Paul said in verse 15, I'm eager. He says, I'm full of passion to get there. I'm full of passion to share. I wonder what would happen in our church. I'm going to be real specific. What would happen in our church if we got passionate, eager, joyful about sharing who God is, not just only in words, but by how we live it out. I wonder if we began to move forward with that same eagerness and zeal that Paul talks about in these seven verses, what would life look like? Here's what I believe. I believe if we do that, we'll see God show up in so many ways, because the gospel is power. And we'll see so many lives transformed. We'll see marriages restored. We'll see people coming into, watch this, a healthy mental space as individuals. Serving one another will be easy because we're doing it with an eagerness and a joy, and we're not doing it to get credit or for somebody to say thank you or for us to get noticed. I just believe if we can move forward like that as we're pressing the reset button and building up to mobilize, that God will do some amazing things. So here's what I want to do this morning. I want to pray to that end, that God would give us that boldness. Hallelujah. To have this kind of report. Yeah. Yeah. To be known. Yeah. For our faith. Oh, yeah. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We honor you. God, we pray that this word stir up in us and does something that only you can do. God, help us to move forward into the things you have for us. Corporately, as a congregation, and individually as people. Lord, may we allow our faith to just take over and be the guide as you order our steps in and out and around trouble and chaos, allowing your light to shine. And when it happens, Lord, may we be boastful in you. May we lift you up. May we make you known. May we glorify you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Listen, friends, we're getting ready to head into Tab Cafe. If you're watching this morning and you don't have a place to call your church home, we invite you to reach out to us via email, thetabernacle@yahoo.com, and we'll reach out to you. If you are a person going, all of this is still new to me, I got questions, or I sense Jesus tugging on my heart, same email address, thetabernacle@yahoo.com. Reach out to us, because we want to reach out to you. Take care, God bless, and see you in a moment in Tab Cafe.